I grew up in a household which basically followed the dictum of Duke Ellington, who said there are two kinds of music. There's good music and there's the other stuff. In our household, one night Stravinsky might be over. Next night it might be Frank Sinatra. Schoenberg could be there. Korngold. But our household was just that way. My parents operated as a string quartet. They operated as film studio musicians. They were freelancers in the recording market. We met everybody. We knew all that. There was no feeling that any music was better or worse than any other one, as long as it was done well. I've always carried that through. And my earliest years in St. Louis, I put together a series in which there were unusual combinations with the orchestra. Indeed, the New York Rock and Roll Ensemble did play with us. Ravi Shankar played with us. We had Wendy Carlos when she was Walter. And I continue that to this day. I don't think about boundaries. There's a comedian and a humorist and political commentator named Lewis Black, and he said that if you hear a song and its significance is only reflected by the music video which you saw, you should kill yourself. Because it means that you've been brainwashed. Not that the videos aren't fine, but that rather than letting the music take you to that special place, that unique place that only you can occupy, you've been taken someplace by someone else. You're part of somebody else's vision. And that's, I think, the crux of one of the problems in today's society. I'm not a social commentator, but I see a distinct problem coming unless we really find a way to trigger all young people's imagination. And the best way to do it is through music and the arts. Young people are the easiest to convince about new music. They don't have the built-in prejudice that older audiences have. They're not frightened off by the names. They don't know them anyway. They don't know Schubert. They don't know Haydn. Some know Mozart, maybe. Some know Brahms. But to them, Del Tredici, Schwantner, Coriano, Adams, it's the same thing as Bach, Beethoven. They all fall in the same category. And plus, sometimes these composers resonate more with young people because they are alive, as opposed to generations that traditionally come to the concerts who seem to appreciate the composers who are dead. Although that's changing too. I don't see the rebellion against new music that we saw 25, 30 years ago. We see much more acceptance because composers themselves have moved into a more varietous state of writing. We can now accept an Elliot Carter alongside a William Balcom, alongside a Del Tredici, whoever it happens to be. You can never know when you commission a work what it's going to come out like. You can't. But having commissioned it, having put your faith and confidence, maybe you can let the composer know that you let him down, but you still go through with it, and for the time you're doing it, it's the best piece in the world. You get out there and you sell it. You sell it to yourself, you sell it to the orchestra, you sell it to the audience. There were a couple that I thought really didn't work and weren't successful. And I knew I would move on after I did the works. Some Philip Glass has been like that for me. It's a composer I really didn't like at one time. I love the early Philip Glass, and then this middle period when he started with the violin concerto. This is awful. And I did the violin concerto, I think, two or three times. And as I got to do it, I really got into it. To the point where I then commissioned Phil to write a piece for me. I got so interested in the structure. Other composers as well have grown on me in such a way that at first I would go, oh, I'm not so sure. The reverse is also true. Sometimes I'll go back and look in planning a season, well, what pieces can I bring back? And I'll see a piece that I might have been excited by when I premiered it and go, you know, maybe it was okay then, now it doesn't hold up so well. That can happen too. When we got to the millennium, I was looking for something that would be a bit different. Something that was unexpected. I'm sure people thought, okay, the National Symphony's going to commission a Coriano or John Adams, or whatever it was. I didn't want to go that way. So I turned to Michael. Now, Michael Kamen was a friend from school. So I talked to him about this. I said, Michael, could you write me a piece for the millennium? And he thought about it. He said, well, what kind of piece? I said, I don't know. Write what you want to write. So the music showed up. I thought it was a wonderful piece. I did it in several places. I can't say I was surprised that there was one person in particular who was not favorably disposed to it, but the venom that he put into writing about this piece was unacceptable, mostly because he got the facts wrong. I think anybody can have an opinion, and you should. But when you venture into attacking someone and you've got your facts wrong, then they're fair game. So you don't say that Michael Kamen was a Hollywood film composer. He's not. He was based in London. You don't talk about his credentials without realizing that he was one of the leading musicians at Juilliard and that his studies with Vincent Persichetti and Jacob Bruckman were of great importance. And down the line, I just sort of went after those things. And very rarely do I send anything back to the press, but this time I had to. I had to defend the composer, I had to defend my friend, but most of all I had to defend musical output. Anybody who writes something is to be commended. To create something out of nothing is the hardest thing in the world. And yet here was this evocative piece, very well received by the audiences, the ones who played here in Washington and the ones elsewhere. So I never had any problem with it. And I still wouldn't have any problems. 2 years from now, I'm going to ask for commissions from, again, people who are not mainstream concert hall composers. Only because I think they'll simply write a good piece. That's all I'm looking for. I don't know how many pieces I've commissioned over the years. It's certainly, it's got to be close to 200 now. Between all the fanfares and the encores and the big pieces and little pieces, I don't even know anymore. And out of that, I'm always surprised and pleased when I see other conductors taking up some of these works. That's the biggest satisfaction, that it lives past its performances with me and other people will do it. I can't even name how many choruses there are here. Every museum has a music series. Every school has something going on. It's hard to go and pick up the paper on Sunday without just being overwhelmed at the number of musical events that are taking place. So in some ways, musically, Washington is one of this country's best kept secrets. We had a gala that celebrated our 75th anniversary. This is, orchestra's been in existence not that long. And in putting together the program, we had Itzhak Yo-Yo and Benny X playing the Beethoven Triple, had some orchestral pieces, commissioned something. I was looking for one Washington edgy moment. I wanted something, and I thought, I've always wanted to do Lincoln Portrait with two people narrating it. One person to do the Lincoln words, the other to do the Copeland words. He didn't know Copeland wrote words, of course he did. He was born in Kentucky, raised in Illinois, so forth and so on. Those are Copeland words. And then I thought, okay, what's the edgy part of this? I know. Narrated by Al Franken and G. Gordon Liddy. And this is great. And I know they get along because Liddy appeared in the first season and the only season of Al Franken's Late Line, the television show that was gone in one season. And I thought, this would be great. Frank will be on the left side, Liddy will be on the right side, and you know, they'll... I just thought the idea of the two of them walking on the stage would be provocative, but fun. Other people said, you can't do that. I said, why not? I said, well, first of all, the event's being hosted by Colin and Alma Powell. I said, yeah. Oh, and then I'm not sure that the Kennedy family would be too pleased to see Gordon Liddy up there. I said, well, maybe we should ask him. They said, just don't go there with that. What we wound up doing was actually have Colin Powell and his wife do it, which was very lovely and very sweet. But I kind of missed the opportunity to do that. It's not censorship, and I understand where they're coming from on it. But one day I'm going to do it. Again, we're really not bound by politics here. When I do the Coriolano First Symphony, I've never had a problem here. But I've had a problem with other orchestras where some people years ago, when it was first written, objected to playing a piece that celebrated people who died of AIDS. And I didn't understand it, but there were some objections on religious grounds. Sorry, it's a great piece of music. I'm going to play it.
Now, I have a question. How many hands do you really need to give this downbeat?
Probably just one.
Because your left hand is doing the same exact thing that your right hand is doing.
Okay.
This hand has to operate in an independent way.
Okay.
And you can use both, but they shouldn't do this, which is what you did. You went, did that. Okay. You don't need to. Like, try it for the moment, just like that. Take the breath. Okay, now that we've established you can do that, what would you want to do with your left hand, do you suppose? What would be the...
Some more expressive? Maybe?
Expressive, or how loud or soft, or the kind of sound you want, anything. But try not to do the double conducting thing. My first thing out of my conducting teacher's mouth was, I did exactly the same thing, and he said, you could have left half of you at home.
Ultimately, what I do for a living appeals to maybe 3.5-4% of the population when it comes down to it. I do not expect people who adore Willie Nelson to come to hear Bruckner. I don't expect people who idolize Linkin Park or Coldplay to come to hear the Webern program at all. I think it needs to be available so anybody can hear it. But as you grow, you define your musical tastes and refine them as well. So even though it's available to everybody, not everybody's going to fall into it. So you have to cultivate those people who will. One of the problems that orchestras are facing seems to be that with declining numbers in audiences in many cities, rather than trying to target those who should be coming to concerts, they reach out to the broadest possible public and they don't wind up with anybody. Having talked a lot about new music and the role of the composer today and all this, we are still bound by the conventions of the last 250 years or so. And Beethoven, Mozart, Haydn, Schubert, Brahms, Mahler can only be tampered with so much. But it comes down to growing and finding new ways to present the music without distorting the music, without resorting to gimmicks to make the music work. Our bread and butter is still the traditions that have caused people to study for 15, 20 years before they get into an orchestra. And like a big, great museum, it has to have specialties, things that identify that orchestra as being unique. To me, it has to do with two things, the sound of the orchestra and the repertoire it plays. I do not think that Palm Pilots with program notes, the big screens going up, all these things that people are trying, date nights, it's all passing stuff. Maybe it helps to get some people in, but ultimately it's going to be how we play and what we play, how we balance it. We have to be careful. We can't bruise this art too much. We can bat it around a little bit, but not much. Ultimately has to heal and evolves but it doesn't really change.